Let us continue. So, this, by the way, we did not discuss in this Pompeiu function the question about continuity of the derivative. Of course, this derivative is discontinuous, at least on set of positive measure. Since if we suppose that not, then it will be Riemann integrable, but of course, Riemann integral must be zero, but function is not zero, okay? So there are some interesting discussion about for this Pompeiu function, but unfortunately we do not have time. So for any function, we define this for Langini, we define this for numbers which always exist in extended sense. They can take infinite value, and we understand that indeed this is generalization of the derivative in the sense that if derivative exists at some point, if and only if all four numbers are the same. Now let's look at simple examples that shows that in principle all these four values may be different. And this simple example here is the first example here. We can take fx, which is x multiplied by sine 1 over x if x is positive, and 2x multiplied by sine 1 over x if x is negative, and 0 if x is 0. So what is the function? The function here, we have x minus x and the corresponding oscillation of the sine, and here plus minus 2x. So this is the graph of the function here. And of course here the is no differential trivial clearly 0. What do we have here? We have the d plus f0, it is 1, because it's upper limit, it's clear, yeah, if you approach the point from the right. Yeah, we have d plus lower plus, it is minus 1. Now we have that this d minus f0, it is 2, because here this is d minus, yeah, f, it is maximal value of the corresponding difference. And here we have that this d minus f of 0, it is minus 2. So please, all these four values are different, yeah? In principle, not it's trivial to construct the function that's given beforehand in values. Now, the second example. Let's take function which is characteristic function of the rational, Dirichlet. Let's take Dirichlet function. Of course, it's discontinuous, derivative does not exist, but we can calculate for any rational value, for any rational value q, what do we have? We have that value of the function now is 1, yeah, for this rational value.
1.
And then we have that d plus of f at this rational value q, it is 0. Is it clear, yeah?
Because we can't arrange slope larger than 0.
We have that d plus, small plus, lower plus of fq, it is minus infinity, clearly,
yeah.
That since we will approach this real point from here.
By irrational, of course.
Then we will have minus, etc. We have that this d minus equals d minus, it is, will be plus infinity. And this d minus will be 0. Okay, so this is the situation.
In principle, maybe.
Now, these Dini derivatives are useful in many situations, particularly in the theorem that we will prove with you now. This is Lebesgue theorem, that monotone function is differentiable almost everywhere. In the proof of this theorem, we will use essentially Vitali lemma that we proved with you before, as I remember. So I just only to recall you that in Vitali lemma, if we have some any set, maybe non-measurable, but outer measure is finite on the line, it measures Lebesgue, and we have Vitali covering of E. So what does it mean, Vitali covering? For any point, for any epsilon, there exists interval from the covering that contains this point, yeah? There exists finite collection of intervals. There are ik from 1 to n from this collection, such that outer measure, there is no measurability everywhere here, of E minus this union I, k from 1 to n, is smaller than epsilon, important that we can choose then disjoint. So we will, there are, you remember that we proved with you two forms of Vitali lemma, today we will use this one. So this is Vitali lemma, okay? We remember this Vitali lemma. Theorem. New chapter, new number. Theorem 1, Lebesgue theorem. F is monotone, so suppose it is increasing, F increasing, non-strictly, then we have almost everywhere there exists F prime, almost everywhere there exists F prime. So this is the theorem of Lebesgue. It's better to write it is increasing on the interval AB, so we will use this mainly for this indefinite integral, so from a to x f dt, so we will consider function on the interval, yeah? And that's not all. Also, we have that integral from a to b of f prime dt or dx less or equal. There is no Newton-Leibniz formula, but there is estimation from above, as f of b minus f of a. So this is Lebesgue theory. Now, before the proof, of course, this is essentially this is less or equal. If you take f as a counter function, that derivative is function is monotone, derivative exists, etc., etc., then we will have that integral of f prime from 0 to 1 equals 0 less than f of 1 minus f of 0 equals 1. So, of course, there are, this is the first example, it shows immediately that sometimes this inequality is strict. Proof. In the proof of the theorem, we will show that derivatives are the same. These Gini derivatives are the same. This is the idea of the proof. So, any two Gini derivatives are equal almost everywhere. Equal almost everywhere. Yeah? Now, let's take, for example, d plus and d minus. We will see with you that it's not so important. Indeed, we can choose any two derivatives, d plus over plus lower plus, etc., etc. And let's show that the outer measure of set X such that we have the d plus fx is not the same as d minus f of x is zero. If we will show this, and if we will see that this choice is not so crucial, yeah,
we can do this for any two derivatives,
then what we will have? Then we will have that there is some zero set where these two derivatives are different. Then there is some zero set such that these derivatives are different, okay,
etc., etc. There are only finitely many sets such that at least two derivatives are different. And if all the sets are neglectable, in the sense that Lebesgue measure will be zero, it means that all these derivatives are almost everywhere are the same, okay? So derivative will imply
that all derivatives are
the same, almost everywhere. Almost everywhere. So this is the idea. This is the idea of the proof.
And we will use the Vitali lemma to some special sets.
So let's take set E as x such that d plus of f is larger than d minus of f. Again, it's not so important. It's possible to show using the same arguments that for another set, such that it is smaller also, it will be neglectable. So just this set can consist of two parts, yeah? Can be decomposed. This derivative is larger, or maybe this derivative is larger. So let's prove that the measure of this set is zero. Now, outer measure. Now, if what is the set? As usual in analysis, we can, in this course, we can decompose, represent this as a countable union of sets, since we want to work with some concrete estimations. For these concrete estimations, we will write here UV. We can decompose, and UV here are any rational numbers, so this is countable stuff, and EUV, by definition, it is just this, the same inequality, but we will put two numbers between. It is d plus of f, larger than u, larger than v,
larger than d minus f of x, of course. Okay? So let us take this set. Let us take this DUV set. Now, there are only countably many of them. So what do we want to show? We want to show that outer measure of UV is zero. This is the problem for any, of course, UV. For any UV. If this is zero, then measure of this set is zero, etc. Now, let suppose that outer measure of this set E UV, it is some constant C, in general no negative. So this is some concrete value C that exists, of course. Now, we will take at the beginning open set G containing UV. So now U and V are fixed, okay? Take open set with the measure, which is closed enough. Measure of G will be smaller than C plus epsilon. Of course, we can do this, since by definition of outer measure, this is infimum, etc. Yeah? Now, for any epsilon, we will do this. Yeah, for any epsilon, there exists this set C. We will consider with U, you can keep in mind, this epsilon is much smaller than the value C, if C is positive, of course. If C is positive, then we will construct some contradiction. So we can do this for any epsilon. We can suppose that epsilon is rather small comparing to C. Now, let us start. I will write here. Let us start from D minus. We have, what is D minus f of x? D minus f of x is smaller than v on everything here on the set UV. By the definition. What is this one? It is lower limit as h negative, f of x plus h minus f of x divided by h. H is negative number. Let's work with positive numbers, h. So this is lower limit. As h now is positive, and here I will change the sign. It is f of x minus h divided by h. Okay? No objections. Yeah? Since I replace instead of h here, I take minus h, and then it will be negative. Now we will change that, and then we will have this stuff. And this is smaller than v. If this is smaller than v, then what do we have? Strictly smaller than v. Then we will have that for any x, and indeed I did not write. We will do this now, discovering Vitali lemma. For any x in the set, and for any epsilon, we can take h as small as we want. There exists h such that. We have that f of x minus h is smaller than vh. Of course, from there, yeah? And this is as small as we want. As small for any x, there exists h with this condition. It is Vitali covering. Now, we construct Vitali covering. Covering of the set UV by intervals with this condition, okay? Clearly, yeah? Please, your questions. There is Vitali covering. We will apply Vitali lemma. Now, by Vitali lemma, we have given epsilon. Epsilon is fixed at the beginning. It's very small. There exist finitely many intervals ik from 1 to n. So what ik? Ik, it is just intervals of the type xk minus hk xk. We will take closed intervals. We'll take closed intervals ik with this condition, of course, such that we have that outer measure. So what is the set uv? It is some set euv. And we will take, this is not covering. It is just some collection of intervals. But measure of the difference is as small as we want, smaller than epsilon, okay? Measure of this difference is smaller than epsilon. So if we take this as a set A,
But indeed, set A, okay, I will define here. A, by definition, is the set UV intersected with this union from 1 to n. But now let's take interior of these internals. They are closed internals. We'll take interior, k from 1 to n, okay? So this is some set, very concrete set A, if you choose corresponding collection of Vitali internals by Vitali lemma. And now this set A, my outer measure of set A, is smaller than C minus epsilon, C plus epsilon. We can do this. We can do this. So, wait a minute, more or equal than C minus epsilon. More or equal than C minus epsilon, since, of course, we will have bound from above. So, please your questions about this choice, about this choice. Why do we have this? Since if not, if we suppose that outer measure of the set is smaller than C minus epsilon, then we'll have a contradiction. Since once more, measure of this set is smaller than epsilon, measure of this complement, and measure outer measure of set E, UV, it will be, by subadditivity, it will be smaller than set A plus measure. Outer measure of set A plus outer measure of E minus the union of internals, okay? And now what do we have? We will have this is smaller than C minus epsilon, this is smaller than epsilon. So this is smaller than C, but it's not true since it is just C, okay? So we can do this, we can do this. We will take A, which is rather close to the set E in this sense. What is more, of course, it is inside of E, since this is intersection. Okay, so this is set A. Please, your questions about that stuff. Now we will use again Vitali lemma. But now we will consider points from the set A. Now, for any y from set A, so what do we have? We have here xk minus hk. Here we have xk, some interval, closed interval from this. Of course, they are disjoint. And here some inner interval, ik plus 1. Now, we will take any point from here. But endpoints are not included. Endpoints are not included since we take here interiors. Now, for any y from this set A, there exists another lens L now, there exists L, such that since they belong to this set, they belong to this set. And in this set, we have that upper Dini derivative of f of y is smaller than u. It is smaller than u by the definition of the is larger than u. Larger than u. This is larger than u by definition of the set, yeah? Therefore, we will have, but what is this one? It is this usual derivative f of y plus l minus f of y, yeah, divided by l. All stuff now is positive. Now, we will have that f of y plus l minus f of y, now it is larger than ul. So, please, your questions, yeah? By definition of the derivative, and by the fact that upper derivative, by definition of Gini derivative, the fact that this is larger than u. This is larger than u. And now, so we will take, we will suppose, I did not write here explicitly, that we will suppose that all intervals ik inside of G, of course we can do this easily, yeah, if not we will decrease the intervals. And also we will suppose that all these intervals J, now these intervals J, will be inside of the interval I. If not, we will decrease it, yeah? So now we will have for any y, we will have some intervals of that type. If you take another point, then for another point, we'll have some other intervals. So we will have then this interval, which is y, and here y plus l will be inside of ik for some k, okay? So please, your questions, interrupt me if you have some, if you don't see some implications. Again, Vitali lemma. Vitali lemma for the same epsilon. We will take some intervals, we will denote now by J. We will take some interval J capital, M from 1 to M capital, yeah? Such that, what do we have? We have that outer measure of this A minus this union, A minus this union, it is smaller than epsilon, but we want to use inequality of the same type. That is now this outer measure of A intersected to the union of this interval j from 1 to m is larger, more or equal than c minus 2 epsilon. We will lose one more epsilon. We will lose one more epsilon, but now we will replace this set A by some another set which is smaller, but again measure will be very close to the set measure of set outer measure of set E from the beginning. Okay, now please your questions about this set. So Vitali lemma two times. Now where is the contradiction? Contradiction here in the following. There are infinitely many of these intervals, of J type. Now we will choose finitely many of these intervals. Of course, they are disjoint, by Vitali lemma. We have finitely many of these intervals. That is, the lengths are very small. The length of the complement, the measure of the complement is very small. Now we will do the following. We will consider increment of the function. Increment of the function. We will consider the sum. This is a value of f of y plus ym now plus lm minus f of ym, okay? So no need to write models, this function is increasing, so this is just some positive value. This is some positive value. So we can, function is here, yeah? Now I will erase it. So function is here, increasing, of course not continuous in general. We consider this increment of these integrals, etc., etc. And if we take the sum of all increments of this function corresponding to choosing collection of these integrals, then this increment definitely will be smaller for integrals that belongs to concrete integral ik. Yeah? Then this sum of increments will be smaller than increment of the function on the whole integral ik. Clearly, since only we will include some positive stuff. And we will take the sum for all integrals of type ik. So what is this? In this, this is the summation for intervals such that jm is inside of ik. Maybe there are no intervals indeed. Maybe it's empty, maybe one, maybe 1 million. But this is less or equal that f of, what is this interval? F of xk minus f of xk minus hk. Please your questions. This is a summation for the intervals inside of ik. And now we will take the sum for all of them. For all of them, yeah? And if you will take the sum, now we will take summation for all k. Maybe before this, now it's time to use the estimations. Since this estimation, it is smaller than v multiplied by hk, yeah? Since this we consider interval of that type. And this is more or equal, strictly more. This is strictly more. Where are the u multiplied by that one? Yeah? So this is the sum of u is the same, u multiplied by lm for summation for some m. But they are disjoint. They are disjoint. Therefore, here we will have this is smaller than the length of the interval ik. Length of the interval ik. And if you take now the whole summation, if you take all summation for all m, that here on the right side, we will have here u multiplied by c minus 2 epsilon. Is it clear or not? Why? Since now we take summation for all m, okay? If you take summation for all m, then we will have common u in front of. But now we will have just the measure of this set. It is just the measure of the set, nothing more. Indeed, since just the measure of this union. We will have just the measure of union of these intervals. But measure of union of these intervals will be larger than measure of that one. And measure of that one, it is larger than c minus 2 epsilon. Question? Okay, yeah? Is it clear? Can I continue? Now, on one hand. On other hand, it will be less or equal. Here we will take summation for all k. Again, v is common. V is common in front of. And here we will have the total length, the length of these intervals. So this is the sum of lengths of intervals ik from 1 to n capital. Since all here, we consider only the intervals of I type, nothing more. But all these intervals at the beginning we took from the set G. And measure of set G, where is written on the previous board? Yeah? It is smaller than V and C plus epsilon. yeah, since this is measure, okay, write explicitly, it is measure of set G, which is smaller than V multiplied by C plus epsilon. So from here, we have not contradiction, but we will have that C is zero. Why? Since now, what do we have? We have now, since this is for any epsilon, this is for any epsilon, we can do this. We can remove this epsilon. So from here, it follows, I will write here, for any epsilon. If we remove this epsilon, we will have U multiplied by C is less or equal than V multiplied by C. But what do we understand with U? That U is larger than V. Of course, we consider it with U, this set, under this, for any rational, but U is larger than V. Of course, from here, it follows that C is zero, since otherwise we will have a contradiction. If we suppose at the beginning that C is positive, then we will do all these arguments for small enough epsilon, and then we will have this contradiction, since U is strictly larger than V. Okay, therefore, only possibility. Please, your questions. Mehmet, another Mehmet. Ata, no questions. Therefore, this measure of this set is zero, so I will continue here. Thus, outer measure, or measure, if it's zero, that set is measurable. Measure of UV is zero. It follows that measure of E is zero. And we don't have time, but I recommend you to see that the same stuff can be done for any two other derivatives. The same can be done for any other Dini derivatives. Therefore, from here, we have that almost everywhere there exists f prime. Please, your questions. That's not all. Since we need to prove this inequality, we will do this now. But firstly, please, your questions about existence of the derivative. Okay? So function, of course, may be discontinuous. It may be discontinuous as the Pompeiu function. Pompeiu function strictly monotone, yeah? And therefore, derivative exists almost everywhere, okay? But it is maybe zero or maybe infinity at some set of points, which is rather large. Okay, almost everywhere there exists derivative. If no questions, I will erase it. And let us prove the inequality, which was stated in the theorem. First of all, we will see that indeed this derivative, of course, is measurable. We will use the following function. Let's take function g for the inequality less or equal fb minus fa. Let us take function gn. As usual we do in this situation, gn of x, it is n f of x plus 1 over n minus f of x, yeah? So, what do we have? Then we will have the following. Gn almost everywhere converges to f prime. Why? Since derivative exists almost everywhere. If derivative exists, of course, it is the limit of the corresponding sequence, since this sequence will give definition, yeah? Now, from here, we have, of course, it can be done for another, by another arguments. It is as a limit of measurable functions. Any monotone function is measurable, trivially, yeah? Why monotone function is measurable? Since you take preimage of the corresponding ray, yeah, then it will be integral. Integral is measurable. If you have monotone function, then preimage of the set, of course, is integral. So we have that, all this stuff, we have this one. Now, and we will use and what is more? And we have that gn more or equal than zero. Yeah? Why? Since function is increasing, monotonically increasing. We are in the position of Fatou lemma. We can apply Fatou lemma. What does it say, Fatou lemma? Fatou lemma says that integral from a to b lower limit of gn less or equal than lower limit of integral from a to b of gn. Okay? But this limit exists. It's not lower limit, it's just the limit. Since we consider this limit in sense of almost everywhere convergence. That is, we have that integral from a to b f prime dx, just what we need since this is the limit, yeah? Less or equal. And now let's look what is this one. This is difference. So this is by linearity. We have n. Now we have integral of from a to b f of x plus 1 over n dx minus integral from a to b f of x dx. Yeah, please your questions. The question is, what is the value of the function if x is larger than b? I forgot to do this. We can do this by definition. We will write that here, let f of x by definition is f of b for x larger than b. So very naturally, to define this function, extend this function as a constant, if x is larger than b, so now we understand what is this. It is just, that's not so fast. Simple substitution gives us the following. So what is this? This is integral from a plus 1 over n to b plus 1 over n. Now function f, just shift, yeah? Minus integral from a to b f. So we cancel both parts, main parts of these integrals. If we cancel main parts of these integrals, we will have lower limit n. And here we have, I hope you see this, yeah? Do you see this or not? b plus 1 over n f minus a plus 1 over n f. Is it clear or not, yeah? Because what do we have? We have integral from a to b. We have integral from 1 plus 1 b plus 1 over n. And here we have minus integral from a to b. So we will cancel this common part. And then we'll have this with plus and this with minus, okay? But here, this function is constant. Since if x is larger than b, this is a constant. So this is identically, this is just integral of constant function. This is 1 over n multiplied by f of b. So we will cancel successfully this 1 over n with this n. And here, I will write this. It is no need to write limit since this is the constant value f of b. And now indeed this is upper limit now. Okay, or maybe it's not so important. What do we have here? Here function is monotone. So function here is more or equal than f of a. Of course, not only here, everywhere, since the function is monotone. If function is more or equal than f of a, yeah, then we will have, since we want to estimate this from above, we will have from here that integral of f from a to a plus 1 over n. It is more or equal than f of a multiplied by 1 over n, since by this bound, since it's a constant, yeah? And now, this is more or equal, and if you take minus, we will have now less or equal. Therefore, we will have that this is just minus f of a. Is it clear or not? Because, look, once more. We have here, this integral more or equal than this value. If we multiply this by n, we will have now just only the value f of a. There is no n here. So we will also we have this result. That's all about the theorem. Please your questions. Important, useful theorem. Now, let us continue. We have to consider today with you at least one more. Wait a minute, this is 6 or 5? What is this chapter? This is 6, yeah, so this is wrong. Now, let's consider the next, 6.3. So, please your questions about differentiation of monotone function. Any monotone function, increasing, decreasing, not so important, is differentiable almost everywhere. The next item, we will essentially enlarge the class of almost everywhere differentiable functions. Of course, we understand with you that monotonicity is rather strong condition, rather strict restriction. But we will consider now with you functions of bounded variations. And we will see with you that now this is rather large class. And any function with bounded variation can be written as a difference of two monotone functions. Therefore, all functions with bounded variation will be differentiable almost everywhere. Definition, let's consider, how we will define the class? We will define this class in this way, these functions of bounded variation on the interval AB. We will see that this set has nice linear structure, what is more, topological structure. So indeed, it is some good Banach space. It's not separable, but anyway, this is good enough. So it is complete with respect to topology that we will define now. But first of all, what is the definition? Definition is the following. For any partition, for any f, no restriction on f now, absolutely any function, again, suppose that is a real-valued function. And for any partition of AB, what does it mean, partition? It means that A, it is x0 smaller than x1, etc., smaller than xn equals b. So we consider only finite decomposition of this interval. We will define with u two values. I did not write this. Indeed, we did it with u before, yeah? So for any value t, we did it with u before, only just to recall it, t plus, by definition, it is maximum of t zero, t minus, by definition, it is maximum of minus t zero. So, of course, from here we have the t plus minus t minus, yeah? Easy to see, for any value, for any function, etc. So, we will define with u p. P, it means positive variation. P will be defined as the sum of f of xk plus 1 minus f of xk plus. So, we will consider only this positive part. If it otherwise it is zero, we take summation k from what? From zero to n minus one. And n small, by definition, it will be the same, k from zero to n minus one. And here the same, but only with minus, yeah? And that's not all. Let's take t as a p plus n. This is also definition of t. So t, it means n. P, it is positive. N, it is negative, and T, it is total, for total, okay? So what is this P plus N? Of course, since we see with you that T, modulus T is T plus T minus, so of course it is just the sum,
so this is
useful, K from 0 to N minus 1, F of XK plus 1 minus F of XK. Now we
take modulus of that one.
We take modulus. So this is the definition of concrete positive-negative variation for function for given partition. Another definition is the following. P capital of F, by definition, is supremum of this, of all small p. Of course, it also depends on p. For all partitions, we consider all partitions. So now, of course, all they are finite, but we will enlarge the number. In the same way we define n, and in the same way we will define t capital. So t capital now, indeed, let's denote in this way. So in order to underline that we consider total partition as a corresponding supremum for the interval AB, since we will consider, of course, it can be written also here for concrete interval. So now this is just p capital ABF plus M capital ABF. So this is total variation. That's not all. Eventually, definition. One more definition. We will say that function has bounded variation on the interval AB if, by definition, we have the total variation of function is finite. So this is well-defined number. Maybe finite, maybe infinite. If this variation is finite, we say that function belongs to set of bounded. We will consider some examples with u. But it's not difficult to see if this variation is finite, if you have two finite functions with finite variation, then of course the sum will again have finite variation. It's easy to see, yeah? And we can multiply this function by coefficient. So this is linear space. It's easy to see that it's linear space, yeah? Linear space, vector space. And what is more?
if there is a linear space, always it's interesting to introduce some natural topology on this space, metric topology or norm topology. Here we can introduce norm. So I hope you remember what is the norm in analysis, yeah? In function analysis, here norm can be taken in the following way, just at this variation. But this variation for constant, it is zero. Function constant variation, of course, is zero. But norm is zero if and only if f is zero. In order to overcome these difficulties, we can take the modulus of value of the function at any point. Well, for example, let's take at point A. Now, this function, indeed is a norm, easy to check, yeah?
It is a norm. Now, uniqueness we have by the second term, okay? And what we will not prove with you, then we will not prove with you that this BVAB, this is Banach space. Banach space means that this space equipped with this norm is complete.
The space is complete. So this is a rather good space. It's easy to see that space is not separable, by the way.
Okay, now, examples. In order to feel the difference between functions is bounded variation, not bounded variations, let's consider with you some examples. The first example, what is the variation on the interval 0, pi of function sine of x? Sine of x, look, your suggestions.
Please, very quickly, we don't have time. 0, pi, and this is function sine of x.
Of course, this variation is...
What is the variation? Look at the picture. We have function of that type.
Yeah, for example, continuous.
So, in order to get the, find this total variation, we want to enlarge. We want to enlarge this sum,
okay?
In order to enlarge this sum, we have to consider here some special partition. Such partition that, for this partition, this difference, or modulus of difference, will be
as large as possible.
Therefore, we have to take, this is the first point, this is the second, this third, etc., etc., for this picture. And then we will have the total variation. It is this value plus this value, plus this value, etc., etc., plus this value and plus this value.
Okay?
Of course, this is two. In order to get total variation, we will, of course, you can consider some inner points, but they will not change this modulus.
Yeah, this modulus.
It's enough to take only three points. Of course, total variation of this function is two. The second, by the way, this is simple problem in calculus. For some polynomial, find total variation.
So, of course, you have to take critical points and consider partition at these critical points and calculate the value of the function critical points.
The second example. The second example,
let's consider a function. What is the variation of function from zero? Okay, first the function. Let's take sine 1 over x. If you take sine 1 over x, if x is not zero, and if zero at zero, then of course we will have the total variation of the function on any interval, small length, is infinity, clearly, since it has infinitely many, yeah? We will, nothing to discuss here, it's easy to see. Now, but not only this one has infinite variation,
but also, indeed, we can take function f of x, now it is continuous. We can take x sine 1 over x. At 0, it is 0. Also, variation is 0. At 0 to 1, for example, or to pi, it will be again infinity.
It's not a function of bounded variation,
but it is continuous.
It is continuous now.
Look, clearly why? Because here, this function has infinitely
many oscillations.
And the size of this oscillation, it's something as 1 over... So, we have this maximal value if xk equals 1 over pi k plus pi over 2 plus xk
minus xk plus xk minus xk.
So, this this will be...
sum of harmonic series with some coefficient, okay? So, this is infinity.
What is x squared? Simple exercise. If we have, I am going to give you the sixth homework, but not only for that one. So let's consider the function x alpha at sine 1 over x. What is more, I will give you here beta next time, okay?
To check whether or not function is continuous, absolutely continuous, bounded variation, not bounded variation, for different parameters. Find the values of the parameters. Integrable in Riemann sense, integrable in Lebesgue sense,
since now it is improper integral,
so maybe it is integrable in Riemann sense, but not at Lebesgue. In principle, yes, it is just the case
for some values of the parameters. So now, this function has bounded variation, not difficult to see, if and only if alpha is larger than 1.
If you take x squared, it will be.
Since now it will be alpha
harmonic series. Alpha harmonic series converges if alpha is larger than 1.
So please, your questions about the simple examples, you have to understand this very well, and to check whether or not the concrete function has bounded variation or not, and what is more, to calculate variation. In some situations also it's interesting. Now I want to prove, I have 5 minutes,
to prove two theorems, two results. The first result, lemma, nothing to do, so we will, indeed we will not do this, just take, use it since it will be applied for the theorem which is useful. So now lemma,
it was 1, now it's lemma 2. If function has bounded variation, suppose that function has bounded variation on the interval AB, it just means the total variation is finite. This total variation of this function, it is positive plus negative, okay? Of course, this is by definition positive and negative. And what is more, we will have that difference, it is, so this is the contents of the lemma, fb minus f of a, it is positive variation of the function minus negative variation of the function. So the proof is straightforward. Indeed, of course, this is supremum, but the proof by, in the, since it's easy to see for concrete partition. If it's easy to see for concrete partition, we have this, and then clearly we can take the corresponding limit supremum. So this is the lemma, and now the theorem. Theorem is the following. A function, this is now characterization. If and only if function has bounded variation on the interval AB, if and only if there exist two finite increasing functions g and h such that f equals g minus h. So any function with bounded function has bounded variation if and only if it is a difference of two monotone functions. Indeed, it's clearly from the lemma what kind of functions you have to take. So theorem is not difficult, as we will see with you now, but the corollary is rather important. If function has bounded variation, that we have that almost everywhere there exists derivative. So once more, monotonicity, strong restrictions, yeah, very strong restriction. Functions with bounded variations, rather wide class. And in this class, functions are almost every way differentiable. Proof, of course, of the theorem, since corollary trivially follows from the Lebesgue theorem. Now, if we have function has bounded variation, how to construct this function g and h? In the following way, we can take g of x as a positive variation from a to x, f, and h of x is a negative variation from a to xf. And then from this property, from this lemma, we will have that f of x, of course it works always, particularly if b is x, f of x minus f of a, it is just g of x minus h of x, you see? But it is just means that it is the difference of two functions. What do we have? We have that f of x, it is one function g of x, it is just number. For example, plus f of a. So this is one increasing function, and this is minus another increasing function. So of course, this function clearly they are monotone. Do you see this? Yeah, because it's supremum. If we enlarge x, then of course we will only enlarge the variation. Clearly, yeah. So this is the implication. One implication, and another. For another application, now suppose that we have two finite increasing functions, and now we understand that f it is g minus h, once more g, h are increasing. Then what do we have? We can fix any partition, and consider the total variation of the function corresponding to this partition. That is, we have the t for this partition of f. What is this? It is just the sum of modulus f of what? F of xk plus 1 minus f of xk modulus for k from 1 to n minus 0 to n minus 1. Variation of this function.
Variation of this function, it is
sum now. It is the sum of g plus h, since what do we have? It is the sum of plus the corresponding sum minus. It's any modulus. Yes? It's any modulus. Therefore, here we have the sum of g, the first one, it is just g, gxk plus 1 minus g of xk, no need to write modulus, it's definitely positive, plus sum of hk plus 1 minus h of xk plus 1 minus h of xk. But the functions are monotone. These functions are monotone, okay? Therefore, look, we have partition. And here for this partition, we consider increment of some monotone function. Of course, this is less or equal than the value of the function g of b minus g of a plus h of b minus h of a. This is finite. This is very concrete number that does not depend on partition. So maybe it's better to write that not smaller than infinity. It is smaller than some constant c. There is some constant c. And we have this for any partition. If you take supremum, from here we have the total variation of the function, less or equal than the same constant c, which is defined by these two functions, is finite. Function has bounded variation. So that's all for today. Now, we have a long break, yeah? So, solve the problems from the homework number 5. Next time I will bring you 6 homework, and the second midterm will consist of will be composed from the problem of the type 4, 5, 6 homeworks. Okay? Okay, once more, have a good holiday, and Bayram Lar. See you in 2 weeks.